Water Corporation is the main supplier of water, wastewater, and drainage services in Western Australia. It helps to ensure we have enough drinking water for the future by developing new sources, increasing water recycling, and encouraging efficient water use.
As our population grows, so too does the demand for water. Our drying climate means we need to find other sources of water now and into the future. I'm in Kwinana, south of Perth, and this is Coburn Sound. Behind those sand dunes over there is the Perth Seawater Desalination Plant. Built in 2006, it was Australia's first large-scale seawater desalination plant. Today we're going to take a look inside.
Hi Oscar, how are you?
Hi Siobhan, I'm good, thank you.
Great.
So Siobhan, tell us about seawater desalination.
Seawater desalination is where we take the salt out of seawater to make it suitable for drinking.
Sounds pretty straightforward.
Yeah, in theory it is.
I'm guessing seawater desalination is a good option because there's so much of it.
It's also important because it's climate independent, which means it doesn't rely on rainfall.
Most of the Earth's water resource, 97% in fact, is salty water found mainly in our oceans. The rest is fresh water, but a lot of it is frozen in glaciers and ice caps. That means there is less than 1% of fresh water in the world readily available to us. So it makes sense for us to use some of the seawater and turn it into fresh drinking water.
I was on the beach earlier and couldn't see any sign of seawater coming in.
Yes, I do have to warn you, you may not actually see a lot of water around the plant, but rest assured there is a lot happening in pipes, tanks, and even below ground. For example, right here is where the seawater is coming in.
So there's a pipe running from the beach up to this point, underground.
Not only that, but the same pipe goes into Coburn Sound for 200 metres.
At the end, 10 metres below sea level, there is an intake tower, 5.5 metres high, which is where the seawater slowly filters in. The top 2 metres have coarse screens that allow seawater to flow naturally through and fish to pass in and out. It then flows by gravity through a 2 metre diameter pipe until it reaches this point.
Back to the process. What's the first step?
The screening process is first up, and that happens in these two units.
Before the raw seawater can be processed through the plant, we need to remove some of the larger particles. Inside the screening units are mesh screens, a bit like fly screens, which trap things like seaweed. Next, it's time for some dosing.
What stage of the process is this?
After screening, we add substances to help with coagulation. Coagulation. It helps smaller particles bind together to make larger particles. When it goes to the next stage, it's easier for these larger particles to be filtered out.
The next part of the process occurs at the dual media tanks, which is a type of filtration process.
So what's inside these tanks?
In each tank, there's a layer of hard coal and a layer of sand. Both layers together take up about 1.15 metres, or one third of the tank. The water filters through each layer, filtering out the larger particles. Then it goes through these cartridge filters. Inside, they're like straws with very tiny holes. The water is pushed through the holes at high pressure.
But haven't all the particles been filtered out already?
Mostly. This is like a backup. Even small particles can block up and damage the reverse osmosis membranes, so we need to make sure they're all removed. In this building is the heart of the whole process, reverse osmosis, or RO. It's a bit noisy in here, so you'll need to put these in.
In here, we have 6 high-pressure pumps that are pumping the water from the cartridge filters to the RO racks. Then the filtered water passes through the RO membranes to remove the salt. In each membrane, there is a tube in the centre, which is where the desalinated water flows through. So, we end up with 2 streams, a desalinated stream, which has no salt, and a concentrate stream that has all the salt, making it twice as salty as the original seawater. The yellow cylinders are recovering energy from the high-pressure salty water coming out of the membranes. They use that energy to pressurise incoming seawater so that the pumps don't need to work as hard. The second stage of reverse osmosis further polishes or cleans the water and reduces bromide levels.
Wow, that was impressive! Oh, sorry about that. But What about all the salt that's now in the RO membranes?
We have to keep the membranes clean by regularly backwashing or flushing them out.
It must also take a lot of energy to run the plant.
Yes, it does, but to make seawater desalination plants environmentally sustainable, we offset their energy requirements against wind and solar farms.
So, can we drink the water now that it's been through reverse osmosis?
Probably not a good idea. Although we've taken the salt out of the water, it doesn't yet have the minerals it needs to make it suitable for drinking.
So, how do you make it good enough to drink?
Ah, follow me. Once the salt has been removed, we remineralize the water in these purple pipes. So inside are the dosing spheres. If you imagine a hedgehog whose spikes or spears are putting chlorine, lime water, carbon dioxide, and fluoride into the water.
I understand chlorine disinfects water and fluoride helps prevent tooth decay.
But what about the lime water and carbon dioxide? What do they do?
Lime water helps maintain the necessary alkalinity levels in our drinking water system, and carbon dioxide helps the lime water to dissolve into the water. In this tank, we're mixing the lime powder with water before adding it over there. Now the water is stored in this tank here before being pumped off-site. It can hold around 12 million litres of water, or roughly 5 Olympic-sized swimming pools.
Okay, so does this water go straight to our homes now?
Not just yet. In summer, first it will go to a reservoir where it mixes with groundwater before being treated again and then being added to our drinking water supply. In winter, when we use less water, some of it is added to dams.
Okay, so we've seen what happens to all the fresh water, but what about everything we've taken out of the seawater? Where does that go?
Once the coagulated particles have been removed, all the concentrate goes through a pipe out to sea about 500 metres and to a special diffuser system that mixes the concentrate with seawater. Ocean tides and currents continue to mix the water. Within 50 metres of the diffuser, the concentrate is back to normal seawater salinity levels. As you would imagine, there is ongoing monitoring of the ocean environment and reporting to the relevant environmental agencies. What you might not imagine is that some ocean life can flourish around this area.
And finally, we have the control room.
The processes are both manual and automated with multiple points of control. The plant is monitored 24 hours a day, all year round, with stringent emergency procedures in place. And, along with other plants, water quality monitoring and testing is critical to ensure drinking water standards are maintained.
Thanks, Siobhan. It's good to know that we have such a large source of water we can use without relying on rainfall.
Yes, it is. But even though our two desalination plants can provide almost half of Perth's water needs today, they still cost money to build and operate. So we still need to be careful about how much water we're using.
Well, after seeing how much it takes to make seawater drinkable, I know I'll be doing my bit. Thank you for the tour.
No worries. See you next time.
Bye.
Bye.